I'm at Singularity University and I'm talking to Brett Templeton, and he had a fantastic presentation this morning about the computerization, but he specialized also on cars and mobility and how that changed. And I'm going to ask him a couple of questions about how that will change society. Brett, thank you very much for coming to Amsterdam. You basically gave us a vision about how autonomous driving cars and the electrification of cars will change society. What are the most? Why is that so important? Why is mobility so important for humanity?
Well, mobility is just an immense part of our lives. So big, in fact, that we've become blind to it. We spend a quarter of our energy on personal mobility.
80% of the oil.
Yeah, we emit a quarter of our greenhouse gases from personal transportation. We've designed our cities around the car. The modern cities have been designed that way. We kill more people than most major diseases. It's the number one cause of death for people under 35.
1.2 million people a year?
Around the world, 1.2 million people. Pretty dramatic. We spend a large part of our lives in traffic congestion. We've given half of our cities over to the car. So being able to change that with software is quite a radical thing.
And what will be the car of the future? Will it be software with a little bit of metal around it, or will it be a car with a whole bunch of computers inside?
Well, it's the same thing, of course, but there are two different ways of looking at it. And I would say that people like Google and the high-tech people coming into it think of it more as a computer that we've got some wheels on to control mobility, and the traditional car companies think of it as a car that they've added a computer to.
Okay. First electric cars, how do you see that developing? I mean, here in Holland, we have a whole bunch of them. In Norway, you saw them. In the East Coast, absolutely nothing. California, a little bit better. How do you see that developing?
Well, so electric vehicles right now are, I'm afraid, more of an enthusiast technology, because the batteries are very expensive. The Tesla Model S, it's a very nice car. It finally has a decent enough range to keep people happy, but it has a $42,000 battery in it, which isn't practical for average buyers. However, that battery price is going to come down, which is going to be good news. But when the cars drive themselves, you don't even need that battery price to come down. We've known how to make a short-range, inexpensive electric car for some time. We just haven't known how to get people to buy it, because quite reasonably, people are afraid of how much range it will have and whether they'll have a long recharge time when the range runs out. Mm-hmm. And because of that, they're not buying these cars in really large volumes. They're modest volumes.
You say, actually, for normal use, 100 or 150 miles is fine. Well, and if you can buy specialized cars for the winter sport, or if you can use specialized cars for the winter sport and any other kind of fun.
Well, the trick is that today people buy cars by going and saying, I need a general purpose car to meet all my needs. They can't buy a car for a specific need. And so while, let's say, a car like the Leaf can only go perhaps 100 kilometers, which is the range of most of the driving people do on most days, but one day out of 10, they drive more than 100 kilometers, and so they say, I can't buy this Leaf because it's not going to meet my needs one day out of 10, and that's not enough. When you can get cars on demand, you can start having vehicles that are shorter range, which meet most people's needs, and if they do want to drive for 500 kilometers, well then, do that in a vehicle with the range to do that. And that might be a liquid fuel powered vehicle, but it wouldn't be all your driving the way it is today.
Yeah.
So when you ask the question, what car do I need right now versus what car do I need for all of my life, you get a different answer, and electric is a much better answer.
For the majority of the movements.
Yeah. Now, electric right now is not great for a taxi, because a typical electric car is designed to run for a couple hours a day, and that's fine because most people don't drive more than a couple hours a day, but a taxi drives much more than that. So to solve that problem, you either need to have battery swap, or you just have more taxis and the taxis
so
are offline.
So we threw out all the taxis in Schiphol here, and everybody, it's all Tesla now in Holland.
Are they? I must admit, I didn't ride in one when I came from the airport. But the Tesla Model S does have that level of range, but again, it's at a very high cost of battery.
Yeah, but I mean, they're coming with a $35,000 car in 2017, so isn't the price of the battery going to come down?
It should. I mean, it's one of the reasons Tesla has invested in building their own battery factory, because they believe they can get the price of the battery down. Now, there are also people who are hoping to get the price of the battery down through new battery chemistries and so on. That's more of a research issue, where until they can really sell it, you can't believe they have it. Tesla hopes to do it just with some improved manufacturing. We're going to have to pause. You're taking everything away?
So what about this self-driving car? How fast can we expect that to basically reach our landscapes?
Well, you'll see some vehicles. You'll certainly see vehicles that you mix driving yourself and they do some driving for you. Already you can do that in a traffic jam, and you'll see more vehicles like that coming out in this decade. Vehicles that can actually run unmanned and deliver themselves to you will start showing up later in this decade, but only over limited areas, smaller quantities. But they'll start changing the world as soon as they do show up.
What needs to be done to be able to build that technology? Is it maps, or is it software, or Is it cheap scanners or...
You have to do all those things. But you also just have to test a lot. I mean, the biggest barrier is really just the amount of time you want to spend making sure it's safe. Because that's everyone's primary goal, is to make sure they built a vehicle that outperforms humans when it comes to safety.
Yeah, it probably has to be a lot safer than humans, right? Because humans
are not so
safe when they use their smartphones or when they're drunk or anything. How safe will we expect the cars to be?
No one has to answer that question. I mean, I can just say that everyone who's making the vehicles is certainly trying to beat human beings, and by a reasonable margin, but it would be wrong to have them try and be 100 times safer than human beings, at least on day one. That's a very hard goal, and would actually many more people would die while we were waiting to achieve that goal. Now, the public may not accept just being a little bit safer. It's an interesting question, but right now, the main goal people have is just to get to that level and see where they go from there.
2030, what percentage do you think will be self-driving cars?
Well, in the world, not a super large percentage, because most of the world will be slower to adopt the technology than the richer countries and the more adaptable countries. However, in the richer countries, I think you should easily see half the cars at that date. And a lot of people switching to doing nothing but that. There's a lot of people who will resist switching, and they'll take it however long they want to take.
Just like ebook readers. So, Brett, we're just debating now in the Netherlands what should be the core goals of education in the elementary and in the high school education. What do you think should be things which the kids are not learning in school and what they basically should do?
Yeah.
They need to learn to be adaptable. They need to learn that they may not have just one career for their entire lives. And so important skills like problem solving, critical thinking, things that teach that rather than for their own sake, but because they teach how to be adaptable. So things like computer programming and math actually are very useful for adapting to other skills. Look at the fields where you see a lot of people study that field, but they don't actually work in that field, but they use what they learn to work in a lot of different fields around the world. And those things actually tend to be pretty good things to learn to make yourself adaptable to a world that's
like
not yet predictable.
What kind of example?
Well, I mean, maybe I'm biased, but I mean, the maths and the sciences are definitely
or good economics or
economics,
law.
Programming, that's right. Things that can let you pick up other tasks and skills quickly are going to do you well in the future.
Thank you, Brett.